1985 to 2001, and to underscore the university's commitment to its Catholic roots and its Holy Cross heritage. I have a couple of announcements this afternoon before I introduce our speaker. First, Dr. Martin, our president, is usually here with us and hosts this gathering. He's in San Antonio. Incarnate Word is inaugurating their new president this afternoon, and it happens to be Dr. Tom Evans, who was a former associate VP here before he left Carroll College as president. So I think Dr. Martin has a speaking part at the inauguration. And I tease because Tom actually reported to me all the time he was St. Edward's, but the president is always allowed to take the place, and so I'm here, and I am actually delighted to be here. I just got back from California, and I think it would not have been smart for me to try to drive to San Antonio this afternoon. So I'm thrilled to be with you, and I'm very, very excited about our speaker. But on one other announcement, St. Edward's is constantly evolving and doing new things, etc. And so you will discover that those of you that come from off campus, we still are doing the valet, but we also have a new parking system on campus. You will not get charged for parking. However, the new parking system, the parking and the risk management area, thinks they ought to know the license plate tags of all the cars that are on campus. So in the future, you will get invited to fill out an online form so that they know you're coming. And that didn't happen for this afternoon, and valet parking will take care of seeing to it that the worst that could happen is you could get a flyer on your windshield that tells you what will happen in the future. Don't worry about it. Nothing will happen at the moment. If by any chance, and I don't expect this to happen, anyone were to get a parking ticket, just direct them to my office, the Academic VP's office. So I think that takes care of the announcements. And then I am really very excited to move into introducing our speaker. Over the past 13 years that we have had this series, we have explored many salient topics for the church in the 21st century. We have on occasion talked about feminism, we've talked about political trends in various areas, particularly in Catholic healthcare. We've talked about America's role in the world with regard to church. We've talked about global Catholicism. We've talked about migration and mission. And we try to explore all of those in terms of what they mean for where the church is moving in this 21st century. And this afternoon, we will turn our attention to the Latinx Catholicism and the future of the church in the U.S. We are privileged, and I do mean privileged, to have as our speaker Dr. Natalia Imperatore-Lee as an associate professor of religious studies at Manhattan College in Riverdale, New York, where she serves as the director of the Catholic Studies Program. Dr. Imperatore-Lee has a PhD from the University of Notre Dame. But I want to reference a couple of things. I went Googling this afternoon. She blanched when I said I got a student's reaction. But I think it's important because we have lots of students here. Dr. Imperatore-Lee teaches the whole range of students. So she's also teaching undergraduates, and then she's dealing with the bishops and the cardinals of the U.S. So it kind of hits the whole spectrum. But I think it's interesting to note that the students particularly appreciate the way she is able not only to challenge them theoretically, but more importantly, to connect the stories of their lives, whatever the diversity of their lives, to connect those stories to the unfolding of church in this 21st century. And I'm sure she's going to do some of that with us this afternoon. The other end of the spectrum is she has been involved in a whole series of conversations across the country with theologians and the bishops and cardinals of the U.S. and has been invited to be parts of those. Those of you that follow NCR, National Catholic Reporter, have probably read some of those conversations. And she was significantly featured in a recent one where the American bishops and the Catholic theologians of this country were really exploring the thoughts of Pope Francis that are expressed in Amoris Laetitia. And so that whole segment, so I said, it's the spectrum that cuts across the entire area. She is also a board member of the Catholic Theological Society of America, to give you some of her academic credentials, and a member of the American Academy of Religion and of the Academy of Catholic Hispanic Theologians in the U.S. Her research interests focus on Catholic ecclesiology, in particular the intersection of popular religion, devotion, and ecclesial identity. She is also interested in issues in the U.S. Latino-Latina theology, including the intersection of Mariology and ecclesiology, theological trends in the Catholic Spanish-speaking world, and the relationship of women, the poor, and other marginalized groups to church structure and governance. Dr. Imperatore Lee, in her lecture this afternoon, will explore the future of the Catholic Church rooted in the experiences and lives of the Latino, Latina Catholics in the United States. Join me in welcoming Dr. Imperatore Lee to discuss Latinx Catholicism and the future of the Church in the U.S.
Or Latinos and Latinas. And mashup. Some people do a like an ampersand or an at symbol for owl. It's very clunky. And I find that I force myself then to alternate, first play the Latinos first, then the Latinas first, and it just gets too tricky and I confuse myself. So the X is just one word. It has an additional advantage in that it includes persons who don't identify strictly within the gender binary, right? Some members of the LGBTQ community, for example. So scholars are increasingly turning to Latinx as a term of choice, and it started really in Latin America and made it to New York. In my remarks tonight, probably I'll alternate between Latinx and Latinos. Sometimes I say Hispanic or Hispanophone to mean Spanish speaking. But that's just a note on language so you know where I'm. Now that we got that out of the way, we can move on to the rest of the title, which has to do with the future of the church in the United States. We know from demographic studies, many of which I'll cite in a bit, that the church in the United States is once again of Latinx Catholics. The way in which we talk about this demographic reality tells an interesting story. Frequently, words like the new face of Catholicism, or the emerging Latinx majority, or the recent immigrants from Latin America are the subjects of our statements. This might lead people to believe that Latinos and Latinas are relative newcomers to American Catholicism, outsiders even. So this brings me to my first animating question this evening, which is, whose experience counts theologically? The Second Vatican Council taught us that the whole people of God have an intuition of the faith, right, a sensus fidei, that recognizes the gospel innately or experientially. This sense of faith allows all Catholics to participate fully and actively in the life of the church, in preserving and promoting the gospel. But for many years, especially among those who chronicle American Catholicism, some Catholics' sense of the faith seemed to count more than others. The church continues its struggle with the matter of the sensus fidei, with the overpowering witness of Latinx experience throughout American history, with accounting for the reality of the people of God and our role in preserving the tradition handed down apostolically. We're left out of the story, or we're let into the story, but only as newcomers. Now, I don't know if you've noticed this, but stories are incredibly important to the way all people learn and engage the divine reality, right? Jesus taught in stories, scripture is filled with stories. It's how we organize our understanding. So when we realize this and ask the question, whose experience counts, we have a lot of food for exploration and discussion. The dynamic realities of story and experience also explain my somewhat weirder, original, bilingual title, Waymaker. Some of my earliest memories involve hearing my mother, that's my mom, 1970s couch holding me. Hearing my mother on the phone with her mother, or one of her aunts, or a friend, saying, Ave, Buena, nice and long on that E, and settling in for what I knew was going to be a very long chat. When I say that word, I hear it in my head in the rhythm and the timbre of her voice. Like an invitation. This won't be a quick conversation. It's a good long one. Catch-up time, right? Now that I have children of my own, I know that picking up the phone is like a magnet to bring your children right to your face. And so I knew when I heard that I couldn't get anywhere near her for a really long time. Have a seat. But cuéntame has a double meaning. While it means tell me, right? Please tell me your story in an inquiring context. When it's said imperatively, it demands that the speaker be counted. Help me, don't leave me out. When we think about the church of the present and of the future, both meanings, to my mind, are vitally important. I want to make three main points tonight that are structured around those two meanings of contar, counting, the accounting and the retelling, or storytelling. The first point is about counting, a demographic one. The second and third are about storytelling, historical storytelling and literary storytelling. So first, the numbers. By now, we've all likely heard the demographic breakdown of the Catholic Church in the U.S. We know that the numbers of Americans of Hispanic descent continues to grow, and that the majority of these persons identify as Roman Catholic. Let me share some outlines of this demographic picture with you. These numbers are calculated and compiled by CARA, right? The Center for Applied Research in New Apostolic and the USCCB. So according to the 2010 US Census, 50.5 million Hispanics live in the United States, and they comprise 16% of the total US population. The population of Hispanics in this country is the second size ranking worldwide as of 2010. Only Mexico has a larger Hispanic population than the United States. 68% of Hispanics consider themselves Roman Catholics, which means that approximately 39% of US Catholics are Hispanic or Latinos. It is a young and faithful population with 64% attending church regularly. This is important for the students in the room. More than half of US millennial Catholics are Latinos. Since 1960, just before the Second Vatican Council, 71% of the US population growth has been due to the growth in number of Hispanics in the US population. This community accounts for 40% of the increase in registered parishioners from 2005 to 2010. About a third of US parishes celebrate Mass at least once a month in a language other than English. Any language you can imagine. 81% of those masses are in Spanish. Overall, about 6% of masses weekday and weekend are celebrated in Spanish in the US. The projected Hispanic population by 2050 is going to be 30% of the total US population. More than half of all the Hispanic population in 2011 lived in California, Florida, and right here in Texas as of July 1st in 2011. There are 25 states in the Union where Hispanics are the largest minority group, and the Hispanic population exceeds 16% in 40 U.S. Catholic states. And half, right? Hispanics make up more than half all over Texas. Brownsville, Laredo, El Paso, and Corpus Christi. I don't have to tell a group of Texans what I assume you already know. This racial and ethnic composition chart that you see is here to show you that white Catholics, in the darker blue, are on the decline, and Latinx Catholics, in the lighter blue, are on the upswing. Right? So you see on the top line a decrease and an increase. And this last map, which I like because it's very colorful, shows you where all the young Catholics live. They live here, in Texas, and in Puerto Rico, and in Florida, but especially. What demographers can tell us about the future of the Catholic Church in the U.S. is that it will in all likelihood be more Spanish-speaking, more diverse, and have more ties to the global South in the coming years. The majority of Roman Catholics in this country will soon be Hispanic. This emerging demographic reality frequently frames the story of Latinx Catholicism in this country. But while the numbers are important, they only reveal part of the picture, or to continue my metaphor, they only tell part of the story. We can count the number of people of Latinx heritage. We can make predictions about future numbers and growth and change, and that's important work. But it's not enough for those of us who consider ourselves ecclesiologists or theologians, right? We want more than numbers. If we want to know whose experience counts, we need to first count the whose. But we also need an account, right? A narrative of who the church is. This is accomplished in two ways in ecclesiology. First, we can tell a historical story. And secondly, we should take account of the sense of the faithful. So let's start with the historical story. The way we tell that historical story is broken. The narrative of North America, I especially love that man. They're glorious. The story that we tell about North American Catholicism situates its origin somewhere in Europe, right, and spreading south and west. History, philosophy, and human experience of salvation history. 50 years after the Second Vatican Council, the church's reality has expanded to reflect its global identity. But the U.S. church's story remains a work in progress. This is a more recent picture of Catholics. And I still bet you, not exactly right. So if narrative is the right form for ecclesiology, then understanding the historical narrative of the church seems essential if we're going to understand the story of salvation history. And ultimately, if we're going to construct a story of the church that takes seriously the genuine variety of Christian experience. In recent years, theologians have indicated the importance of the experience of particular local churches in accounting for the genuine diversity and legitimate variety of local Catholicism. In contrast to what theorists call grand meta-narratives, right, like big overarching stories that try to make everything fit, an emphasis on stories of particularity allows ecclesiologists to avoid marginalizing non-dominant voices. So telling particular stories in all their diversity, canonically, reveals the invariable core of the Christian message in all its various cultural, historical, and linguistic perceptions. So what I mean is, the more particular the stories we tell, the easier it is to find ourselves represented in a story. It seems counterintuitive, right? Like, how can I find myself in the story of an Asian Catholic? But I do. If we try to tell general stories, we feel alienated from. Even particular narratives have the potential to marginalize some accounts in favor of others. In the U.S. context, the experience of Latinx Catholics has been made to fit uncomfortably at times into a particular historical narrative that emphasizes the arc of immigration and what they call Americanization. In addition, the Latinx presence in American Catholicism, viewed through the lens of immigration, is frequently called the future or the emerging or the coming reality, just like I just said. The features of Latinx Catholicism, its popular religious practices and devotions, its worship style, are often treated as if they were recent developments, only now or in the past few decades arriving on American shores. Even more worrisome is the scholarly treatment of Latinx and Black theologies, sometimes called contextual theologies, like the other ones don't have context, right? Often lumped together in a group and frequently relegated to the margins of theological discussion, and sometimes literally when they're in the last chapters of books or the last week or two of a syllabus. Have you ever been in a class like that, where you do philosophy, and then the last week you do Black philosophy? Or you do theology, and then the last day you do family theology and Latino theology. And people are not. Rarely are the insights of these so-called contextual theologies allowed to drive the mainstream narrative, right? Which is also a narrative that has a context. So they're in danger of being reduced to scholarly sidebars or adornments. So in a globalized world, telling the story of the world church demands more than an add diverse voices and stir theology. The insights of Hispanic theology fundamentally disrupt the narrative of ecclesiology, and they provide a dangerous memory, to use a phrase from Metz, of the Hispanic presence in the U.S. What is that story? It varies, but for the most part, the story of American Catholicism is told. If we look at it geographically, and you'll have to like know your US geography here. From the Northeast, right, Maryland and Pennsylvania, and it moves south and west with the pioneers. Okay? Implicit in that story, though, are assumptions about what real Catholicism is, what constitutes civilization, and about the relative barrenness, at least in terms of Catholicism, but also in terms of virgin land, lack of civilization, of anyone or anything who might be encountered outside of the Atlantic corridor. Narratives about the relationship of Catholicism and human history still tend to overlook uncomfortable themes arising from the church's complicity, the church's participation in racial, colonial, and patriarchal tensions. In his recent book, Latino Catholicism, historian Timothy Madarina makes a case against the prevailing models for understanding Catholicism. So what Madarina wants us to do is to identify in the history of American Catholicism a pattern that he called the Americanization paradigm, and to replace that with what he calls the hemispheric paradigm. So he wants us to zoom out, to not just think of the Americanization of Catholics as something that happens in the borders of the U.S., that map I just showed you, but rather a more hemispheric view that looks at America from Canada to Chile. He does this to critique what seems to be a bias among religious historians, especially historians of U.S. Catholicism, who tend to, as he says, focus on the eastern seaboard and European settlers and immigrants, while ignoring significant portions of the population, including Black Catholics, women, Asian American Catholics, and of course, the inhabitants of the frontier lands in the West and the Southwest. While the U.S. Church is certainly undergoing a demographic shift right now toward the Hispanic majority, and many of those Hispanics are immigrants, Spanish-speaking Catholics have lived in what is now the United States for twice as long as the nation has existed. That's directly from Madavina, and I was blown away when I read that sentence. We are shameful because it's my heritage too. Not all the Catholics in our country are immigrants. I don't have to say this too much in Texas. There are non-immigrant Catholics in the southern and western parts of this country who were incorporated into the United States in the process of westward expansion without migrating at all. Latinx Catholicism is an integral part of the story of the U.S. Church, and it goes against the dominant paradigm where a group of people migrate to the United States from another place slowly and often with the help of institutions like the church. The community learns English, they get jobs, they educate their children, they leave behind their customs or modify them to fit the present context, and in doing these things in a generation or two becomes American. Right? This is the story of the Irish and the story of the Italians and all these other immigrants. Madavina said that non-immigrant Hispanic communities challenge that vision of immigration and slow assimilation, with Americanization being the goal, that characterizes the experience of European immigrant communities in the Northeast and the Midwest. The reality of these non-immigrant Catholic communities continually existing here in Texas and all over the Southwest complicates our narrative of U.S. history. But if history is to be true to reality, it has to include uncomfortable and disruptive realities. The legacy of non-immigrant Hispanic Catholicism disrupts these ideas. And it doesn't disrupt understanding in the past. When we acknowledge the constant presence of Latinx Catholic communities in the U.S., we temporarily sort of check the narrative of Hispanicization as an emerging reality, never before seen in this country. Sure. This is a moment where Hispanics are on the upswing, but it's not new, it's a constant. By reconstructing the past in a more hemispheric way, we contextualize the church's present. Instead of picturing Catholicism as something that arrived on American shores and spread westward and south, like Manifest Destiny, it might be beneficial, and surely we have to reflect reality better, if we envision Catholicism existing and emerging in multiple places in the land we now know as the United States, all the same. So not Manifest Destiny, but more like that Verizon map. That's what I mean. I mean, maybe not in the far, far north, right? But certainly in the Southwest, right? It's just popping up everywhere at the same time, not moving unidirectional. Ultimately, a historical reframing like this, acknowledges the dangerous memory of Latinx experience in all its varied forms. Ecclesiologically, this dangerous memory, it protects us against naive understandings of American Catholicism as an immigrant European reality, but also against a uniform European Catholicism, right, that never existed. It helps us understand the American past as more complicated than we thought, which is good. And it helps us view European Catholicism as more complicated than we think, which is also good. To give you only one example, let's take the Catholicism of Spain and Portugal, which is the early export to the Americas. There's a Latino historian in the Bronx, a Latino colleague named David Vadillo, and he notes the Iberian roots of Latino Catholicism. He describes Iberian Catholicism as somewhat pre-Trent, right, that it developed before the Council of Trent, largely because the Pyrenees Mountains insulated Spain and Portugal from a lot of the reforms of the Reformation. Mountains are hard to get over, and information is hard to move over mountains. So today's Hispanic Catholicism reflects a blend of pre- and post-Trent brought to the New World first with Columbus and then with many other ships, was a different sort of thing from the Catholicism practiced in other parts of Europe, especially those parts that contended with the philosophical and intellectual challenges of the Reformation. For Valido and others, the Catholicism preserved in Latin America reflects the popular faith lived in rural Spain. I don't know if you've ever seen or been to Sevilla, for example, the Holy Week celebrations in Seville. There's a lot of that kind of religiosity that persists in Hispanic or Latin American Catholicism. It largely escaped transorganization of church life into the parish structure. It escaped a lot of the regularization of sacramental practices and the centralization of power in Rome. Instead, Iberian Catholicism became the focus on local clergy, right? Not the Roman Church, which was associated with religious orders in Spain, and popular religious devotions, right? Such as home-based practices like Ayacitos, which you see on the bottom, or Posadas, which you see on the top. This is very different from the characteristics of good Catholics that I hear about in the Northeast. Those characteristics include regular attendance at the parish church, subdued modesty in prayer, silence of the most important kind of reverence, etc. Even in Europe, the reforms of Trent took hold over time and to varying degrees. So the Catholicism that came to the Americas from different parts of Europe varies. The stories and practices we emphasize when we talk about immigrant reveal our assumptions not only about what we're trying to find as American, but even about the complexity of what we consider European. What we see as exotic or immigrant really depends on where we sit. Those are relative terms. And we should take care that we don't associate exotic or immigrant Catholicism with a sense of superior fervor or secrecy, right? You hear this a lot. Oh, but the Latino Catholics, they have such simple faith. And I detect a kind of weird paternalism in that makes me really uncomfortable, right? There's a lot of nuanced critique coming out of Hispanic and Latin American Catholics that goes way beyond this kind of simplistic, oh, Padrecito kind of faith that is the caricature of it here in the U.S. In the end, neither American Catholicism nor European Catholicism is a fixed uniform reality. And if you look at either of them closely, you see that there has always been genuine, legitimate variety in Catholic religious expression. Catholicism in Europe was and remains as mixed and diverse a reality as American Catholicism, and this unity in diversity that is produced by Christianity's now global enculturation is a historical mark of the church, right? It's a central characteristic. So if we can talk about even European Catholicism being of mixed heritage, I think it's safe to say that all Catholicism is what Hispanicers call mestizo, right? It's a mixed hybrid reality of context and enculturation and faith. Likewise, there's no such thing as European Catholicism, but schisms, right? There surely exist American Catholicisms and Latin American Catholicisms, Asian and African Catholicisms in the present day. Both Badillo and Madalina make the point that any presumption of a uniform Hispanic Catholicism is unfounded. This presents us with a problem, though. What about the church's unity? What happens, you know, when we say we believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church, what happens to that one in all of this variety? What sort of unity can coexist within a genuine diversity of authentic Catholic expressions worldwide? Keep in mind, I'm not saying that this is a new emergent reality we're moving toward, or a brand new world that's just starting now. I'm saying this diversity has always everywhere been the case. The uniformity we hear so much about, where Catholics pray the same way everywhere, at least the good ones do, which may have begun with Trent, but certainly didn't take hold universally, maybe it never really existed. Instead of experiencing that as a profoundly unsettling event, and maybe you do, we can also view it as really freeing. It's not different or scary. It's normal, even if it's a normal that we didn't know was there. The best way to get to know the variety that exists in Catholicism is to listen. In particular, to return to our theme, I think we need to listen to people's stories, and I hope that at the end I'll get to hear some of your you're going to. Now, it's impractical to assume that I can interview every single person here at St. Edward's, let alone every single Catholic in the United States. But there are other ways, I think, that are productive of listening to the people of God, and it's vital. I think this notion of listening is best encapsulated in an excellent quote from Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie. She writes, "Many stories matter. Stories have been used to dispossess and to malign. But stories can also be used to empower, to humanize. Stories can break the dignity of a people, but stories can also repair that broken dignity. If we want to honor the dignity of the whole people of God, then it is important that we tell their stories and listen to the stories they tell. So now I'm moving to the literary part of the talk. Wayne Dunning, remember that word, is ultimately about more than being counted, right? Though quantifying is important. And it works against that flagging out that I'm talking about over and over. But it's not the only kind of accounting that we need to do. So my final point tonight seeks to explore only one other kind of accounting, which is the arts, especially literary narratives that reflect reality. Explicitly anyways. It is in these pockets of reflected reality that the sense of the faithful can be discerned. And only in conversation with these realities that an ecclesiology for the third millennium begins to emerge. Rather than abstract principles apply to reality, right? The church is one holy Catholic apostolic. Let's look for the ways in which that's happening in the real world. Yes. But what if we look at what's happening in the real world and then see how that makes the church one holy Catholic apostolic? The way I do this is by looking at artistic literary narratives. And I think theology benefits from exploring the ways authors of literary works portray Christianity, the church, personal devotions, as well as the way they reflect understandings of God, salvation, sinfulness, and redemption. Theologians can use this material, instead of ignoring it, to create or refine theological formulations, to understand how the church works in a given context or place, or how doctrines reflect the beliefs and practices of a group of people depicted in the form of a literary narrative, or the ways in which the author understands the doctrines and the practices of faith. Literature serves as a resource for theology's role as a reflection on experience, because it depicts experience. In addition, theologians approach literature as a source for theology. So Michelle Gonzalez, a Latina theologian, notes that theology and literature share the ability to express the divine presence in people's daily lives. Maybe you've noticed this when you've read a book that you really loved, right? That really sort of depicts someone's spiritual journey or someone's relationship with God. Gonzalez reminds us that Christians have known God to be the good, the true, and the beautiful. And a key source of the beauty in literature lies in its capacity to portray reality in a true way. So if literature portrays reality through artistic means, can be a source for theological reflection, especially because I think Latina theology emphasizes the grace-filled nature of ordinary life. So when we look at literature and we're watching the depiction of someone's ordinary life, if Hispanic theologians have been saying that grace exists in the everyday, right, when you're reading a story, even if it's a fictional story depicting something true about everyday life, there's a way in which you can overhear grace. So literary works serve as source and resource, right? They give us new understandings of God, self, and other, and they, most importantly for me at least, literature and art and movies and television allow us to overhear the sense of the faithful in everyday settings. So a key insight in Hispanic theology is that ordinary life, especially ordinary life of the laity, is a place of extraordinary grace that gets overlooked, unfortunately, by mainstream theology. Because theologians tend to get caught up, in doctrines and philosophical frameworks. It's really big, your point. I know you're not bored now, but the incredibly rich lives of the laity, right, the majority of the church, it goes without analysis or attention because we're so caught up in these frameworks. But how should we study the faith of the laity? Well, there's a lot of ways that you can do it, right? You can make polls, you can look at demographic data like I just did, you can read histories, but one way, I think, is through art, and especially literature, precisely because of literature's ability to portray reality in a true way. By chronicling the lived reality of characters, literary narratives reveal religious understandings embedded in culture, language, and practices. So now I'm going to turn to one of my very favorite stories about the faith of the Lady. It's a very brief personal essay called The Battle of the Virgins by Puerto Rican author Rosario Ferre. That's her on the right. Ferre's essay, which, you know, we never know if it's an autobiography, it's written in the first person from the point of view of a young girl. It showcases the tension between religious elites and the ordinary faith of the people. And it reveals that in ordinariness, a complex faith that is rooted both in traditional devotional practices and prayer, and that subverts a repressive patriarchal system. So I'm going to read you two little bits of the story. Here's the first one. This is the narrator's speech. No sooner has she begun to pray when I asked, "Why is La Guadalupe black? All the other virgins I know are white and blonde, and they have blue eyes." "She's not black. She's brown. She was buried in the ground for 800 years. The dirt stuck to her, and now she's the same color as the rest." "How was she buried in the ground for 800 years?" I whispered. "Because some bad men wanted to harm her. I saw the story in Tizoc, a Mexican movie I went to. Pedro Vanda tells how La Guadalupe was hidden away in a cave in the mountains because they wanted to destroy her image. It was such a beautiful movie. Every time Maria Félix appear on the screen, Pedro Infante and his mariachi just play the guitar for her, just like my boyfriend does for me." This scene represents the first catechetical moment between the narrator of Ferre's story, who's probably her, but we don't know for sure, and he not includes her nanny in the story. It also, I think, crystallizes the difficulty of getting at the sense of the faithful by looking at popular religious practices. Namely, that people's beliefs tend to be extra-doctrinal or non-doctrinal, informed as much by popular beliefs and customs, and in this case, movies, right, from popular culture, as they are by magisterial or Catholic teaching. But this doesn't mean that practices and beliefs are irrelevant. In fact, I think the opposite holds true. The scene shows us how different kinds of knowledge and complex ways of making sense of things come together into a fundamental understanding of divine activity in the world that makes sense both to the central teachings of Christianity and the faith of real Catholics. So the narrator is a little girl who lives in Ponce, Puerto Rico, and she joins her nanny at the cathedral, praying before a side altar of La Guadalupe. She's engaged, right? If you look at this from the outside, it's sort of a classic, almost stereotypical depiction of Hispanic religiosity, right? Two women kneeling in front of La Guadalupe praying. It happens all the time in Texas. It's Hilda's interpretation of Guadalupe's story, which is influenced by all kinds of things, right? Including a different Guadalupe, right? The Guadalupe from Spain that was actually found in a cave, right? And had been buried in the ground. The Mexican, the Nahuatl narrative of the Hija Memohua, which is the sort of narrative of Guadalupe, the one we know. And a movie about Mexico that involves the story of Guadalupe that stars Maria Félix, who was like this, you know, she was like, Jennifer Lawrence of Mexico. But among all those influences, Hilda is able to subvert the traditionally pious message of devotion to the Virgin of Guadalupe. And she replaces it, or at least nuances it, with an understanding that I think you'll find differs from traditional Mariologies. This is what Hilda says. La Guadalupe is a very powerful Virgin. You don't want her as your enemy. Those swords, the narrator thought that they were swords coming out, are thunderbolts. She's not a handy version like those of the other churches. She gets things done, and she protects people exactly what they want. God, I love that. Here, Hilda picks up on the little girl's misreading, and I don't think there is, a misreading of those rays of light. The little girl thinks that they're samurai swords. She kind of digs that, right? And the nanny's like, "No, they're not, but they're thunderbolts." That's cool too, right? And she uses the little girl's misreading to emphasize the power of the Virgin, right? Unlike those other nanny virgins, like the Immaculate Conception, which is revered by the narrator's mother, right? Guadalupe is not passive, she's not long-suffering, she's not placidly standing on a bed of lilies. while Uka represents for the nanny, Hina, and for her charge, a powerful woman who protects those who follow their passion. It's a subversive message for a young female nanny to hear, and for a young female nanny to proclaim. Why? Well, both the narrator and Hina were expected to conform to gender and class roles. For the narrator, this meant aspiring not to an education, but to being society, forever pure and therefore holy. For Hina the nanny, the expectations were far more extreme. Her family's poverty made it nearly impossible to fathom an education or any sort of liberation from the life of poverty to which she was surely doomed. And yet, at the end of the short story, neither woman conforms to the norms expected. Hina improbably is able to leave the island, she becomes a nurse, and the narrator gains the courage to also leave Puerto Rico for boarding school and college in the United States, and she becomes a writer. Ferrer's story ends with this observation on the part of the now adults. So she grows up and tells the story backwards. And she makes this observation as an adult. Hina's life had been heroic. Let's think about the juxtaposition of Hina, a victim of the double rejection of being a woman and a Latina of the lower class of Puerto Rico and the mainland here in the US, with the heroic virtue of Guadalupe as she understood it, and the narrator, right? They understand Guadalupe as a powerful virgin who protects those who fight for what they want. What Hina wanted for herself and for her young charge was to break away from the expected roles and into a life of one's own, a life that was marked for Hina by love and passion and education. Both Hina and Aria find this by leaving their home and then seeking out something new. In showing us their subversive prayer and teaching in the context of devotion to the Guadalupe in Portis Cathedral, Ferrer ties popular Catholic practice to goals that we would characterize today as feminist, right? The self-actualization of women, their education, women's capacity for self-determination. This is my kind of story. It is in a number of ways my story. And in all its particularity, rooted in the 1940s in a small city in the south of Puerto Rico, it reveals itself to be the story of many women. I want to end this evening with a little bit more art by Yolanda Lopez, a Chicana artist based in Southern California. Interestingly, she and Ferrer belong to the same generation but never met. They both paint pictures of Guadalupe. Lopez with on canvas and Ferrer in words. You all know, I assume, what the classic image of Guadalupe is. Now, here's Lopez's. She got a lot of flack for this. And so did I, unexpectedly, when I posted it on Twitter last December. Wasn't expecting people to get so offended, but many people are disturbed to see Guadalupe depicted this way, right? In a shorter skirt, or at least the skirt's kind of flying up, as you see, in running shoes. She's a strong woman. She's got her shawl kind of thrown over her back. She's dynamic and forceful and coming right at you. It looks, to me, like a depiction of the Guadalupe that Hina's praying to in Ferrer's story. When I discovered these in the course of my research, I couldn't believe the synergy between this and the powerful virgin who protects those who fight for what they want. Right? If I was going to draw the powerful virgin who fights those who, this is what I would come up with, 100%. Right? Somebody in tennis shoes was willing to like just go for it. Here's my very favorite book of Lopez's paintings. It depicts her mom, Margaret Sand, as the virgin. This woman looks exactly like my grandma, who also had a Singer sewing machine, and that haircut, and that body type, and that look in her eye, and over her glasses. Exactly the same. Maybe it looks like someone you love. What amazes me is that this very particular image, a portrait of the artist's mother, revealed so much to me about my own grandmother's everyday holiness. Imagine seeing our grandmothers, our mothers, our aunts, painted as saints in all their heroic. Particular narratives, especially literary narratives or art, whose beauty lies in their capacity to represent reality in a fresh perspective, highlight for me the unity and diversity that has always been a mark of the church. To my mind, the faith of ordinary people is embedded in narratives like these. In a particular way, the work of Latina authors like Pepe and many others allows us to to glimpse what anthropologist Anaya Diaz-Stevens has termed the matriarchal core of Latinx Catholicism, right? In other words, that women form sort of backbone of Hispanic Catholicism because they are in charge of preserving it and passing it down. In the story of Hilda and her charge and their interaction with La Guadalupe, we see hints of catechesis, of cultural retelling, of the interaction between popular culture and popular religion. It's in these intersections, I believe, that the Holy Spirit resides, that grace erupts, that the story of the church is told. Consequently, by analyzing these narratives, theologians can discover the sense of the faithful, that infallible intuition of faith that belongs to the Holy People of God. The story of the people of God, ecclesiology, is enriched by and transmitted through well-told stories like the faith. It makes their experience count. The reality of Hispanics in the United States is complex. The history is long and riddled with conquest, with violence, and with cultural appropriation. The demographic story of American Catholicism continues to shift, our church's gaze turning southward, our churches themselves turning more and more Latinx. In this time of flux, we must not forget to ask, whose experience counts? And how do we go about counting and accounting for the experience of the marginalized and the excluded in our midst? Wendoming is my approach to an initial account, but it's also a threefold invitation. Wendoming about American history without leaving anyone out. Wendoming about some well-told stories that highlight the role of women in catechizing and passing on the faith in developing doctrine. And finally, wendoming your story, that in so doing, we might recognize the unity and diversity that binds the whole church into one people of God. Thank you.
And before we have a Spanish mass, we struggled to get a Spanish-speaking priest. Do you think that maybe Pope Francis and Holy Father talked about female deacons and also celibacy, and maybe I think in Brazil, the married priesthood, do you think that would be helpful and good with the Spanish community?
It might help. I think that the Latino community wouldn't be opposed to it.
on there. I'm a junior colleague of Dr. Brogan Morris in the same department. I just wanted to thank you for being here. I think we're very fortunate to have you come and speak to us. I teach historical theology, and it seems to me that the virtues you are talking about in your talk of specificity and complexity and inclusivity are helpful in a historical theological sense, even beyond talking about Latinx Catholicism in particular. The question I wanted to ask you, though, it's something that I think, it's just something I'd love to hear you speak a bit more about. It's something that comes into your talk about Latinx Catholicism, and it concerns the way in which the power of storytelling or narrative to increase inclusivity can speak to this particular tradition, and it concerns the indigenous American population. And so I'm just curious if you and your research, and even in this particular picture, actually, have come across any really interesting stories that deal with how Catholicism has absorbed and neglected or celebrated the indigenous element of Latinx Catholicism.
She left the church in large part because she found that the depictions of Guadalupe, right, which she was assaulted with everywhere she looked, right, drugstores, bodegas, what have you, were sort of deracialized, if you will, and they didn't look like her, they didn't look like anyone from her family, and I think it was a sort of erasure of the indigenous community from the iconography, even. And if you notice, some of the prayer cards that came out when Juan Diego was canonized had a really European-looking Juan Diego on them, which is the opposite of the point. Right? So I think that we, in our desire to tell a story that we think everyone can buy into, what we end up doing is telling false stories. You know, this is a historian. And so, yeah, I think that the erasure of the indigenous experience is something with which we are still contending, certainly in this country, but also in Latinx theology. So I was in Peru this summer, and we visited Machu Picchu, and we saw, you know, we visited all these museums of cultural anthropology, and the sort of richness of the pre-Incan empires, which I never learned about in school, blew me away. Right? It's totally erased or flattened into, well, before Columbus got here, there were indigenous people living here, and now they also live here, I guess. You know? So I think that one of the things that is attention to particularity that allows those aspects of Latinx Catholicism to come forward. And certainly in the popular religious devotion, there's so much indigenous practices. Indigenous sort of flavor that is retained, often without even acknowledging that that's what it is.
Hello. So, talking about depictions of Our Lady of Guadalupe, I have a kind of more like, practical question, which is that I've been looking for alternative versions of the Virgin of Guadalupe, and I was just wondering if you had come across any other artists like Yolanda Lopez who are doing alternative versions, which maybe the answer is no.
There are people who like it, I don't know their names, but they've written whole books on tattoos, on the version in tattoos, which is amazing. And I found one that I put up, not on Twitter after I got in trouble for this. Not in trouble, like people got really mean. They get very offended. There was one, it's a Chola Guadalupe, and it's, you know, she's got this beautiful makeup on and big hoop earrings, which I'm not wearing today, but normally would. And it's and a tattoo across her chest that says Madre de Dios. And I thought, wow, this really kind of, and I'm sure it's like one of these digital art creations that somebody does like for Tumblr, you know, mm-hmm. or something.
Yeah.
And who knows if it was born of like someone who was trying to be subversive on purpose, but I found it to be so exciting and liberating and sort of inclusive of people we don't think of as being deeply religious but are. So yeah, I can actually, I'll send you the image, or I can put it up, no, I'll put it up here. And show you, because it's really amazing. It's really beautiful. I think that the creative ideas, the problem is that many of the more traditionally minded Latinx Catholics really do get offended. And we sort of need to have some sort of sensitivity to that, because there is this kind of sense, and a lot of it is wrapped up in a little bit of patriarchal investment in having Mary be in a particular kind of way, right? Looking down, being, you know, hands folded, and sort of not taking up less space. That seems to be very important. And this kind of dynamic Mary frees people up.
Thank you so much. Wonderful talk. I really loved it. And I definitely appreciated how you use narrative and images as sort of a locus of theology. So this is a very theological talk. I really appreciated that too. Analogously, theologians will talk about flor y canto as a theological discourse. And, you know, it's not just the songs, there's some in church or, you know, the pretty colors, but you know, this is really theology. So my question is more, could you kind of take what you're doing now, which you spoke of today, and kind of put it in dialogue with Flor y Canto? Because I'm just curious, is it essentially the same thing, or do you see qualitative differences in terms of what you're doing? You know, I'm kind of getting at sort of, you know, the breadth, you know, within this particular way of doing theology, you know, that are some interesting particularities.
Yeah. I think that Flor y Canto tends to identify a particular kind of aesthetic term in Latino theology. When I went to graduate school, I had no idea what that was, because I'm Cuban, and Cubans don't use that terminology at all. It's much more sort of African Caribbean than indigenous North American. So I had to learn a lot about it. I get sort of semi-satisfying definitions of what it is. I kind of have a sense of what it is, this sort of aesthetic desire and celebration, and that is an integral part of the experience of God, and not as something that is added on later or as an adornment or something like that. And I think that that's basically what I'm trying to do here, right? It's to take the aesthetic turn, but not as something because it's nice, right? Or because it's beautiful, but because it's true, right? Because truth is embedded in that. And I think that certainly this kind of, even in the Nicaragua, the way in which all of the senses are engaged immediately, right? The song, the sounds of the birds, the smells of the flowers, everything like that. The way in which the experience of God is embodied and sensualized, right? Which happens for us now, yes, in sort of liturgy and stuff, but also through art, is a really sort of rich area that theology has ignored.
You mentioned the three transcendentals in your talk, and that came through, so that kind of suggests the structure that you use. Thank you so much.
Thank you. It is regarding of the piety, religiosity, you know, the topic here even in the United States, and they come in, you know, for Latin American countries. Because I'm originally from Peru, South America, we've been there, and also there's the famous image of the Lord, the Señor de Milagros, you know, and here in the United States, you know, in different big states, you know, like in Newark, they celebrate the Señor de Milagros in October, with all of these purple habits, you know, that these are just present. And you come across, I mean, it's Guadalupe. But what about another little details, you know, the piety, you know, for Señor de Milagros, or any other devotions, they are in different countries. It's one question. The other question is, how do you relate in between the Latin American religiosity and then the Latins, you know, in America? I think you can have any comments on it.
Thank you very much. And yes, when we were in Lima, we saw the Milagros. It's amazing. The richness, I think, of the Latin American devotions, not only to Mary, although to Mary in many different guises, but also to things like the Señor de Milagros, to the Miraculous Medal, even, like all kinds of things, is underexplored in the United States. In the United States, it does get flattened, I think, a little bit. What I like, the reason that I chose this particular Guadalupe is I really did think that there's a lot already done on Guadalupe, just kind of played out a little bit. But what was interesting to me is that this is a Puerto Rican take on Guadalupe. So the Puerto Ricans have a completely different relationship to Guadalupe. It's not the sort of foundation of a nation state or a foundation of their sort of identity or anything like that. It's very much just a religious devotion that is unique in its Caribbean-inflected understanding of this non-Caribbean virgin. I remember, maybe it was before I even got to Notre Dame, maybe the summer before, there was a conference on Ecclesia in America. And it was right when John Paul II was going to declare Guadalupe the patroness of the Americas. And there were bishops all from all over Latin America, and the uproar was insane. Well, what about Santa Rosa de Lima? What about Nuestra Señora de la Caridad? What about all of these virgins, like Alta Gracia, whatever, whatever? People were very upset because they thought that it was the elevation, or worse, the erasure of their own particular devotions that for them are really the cornerstone of their Catholicism. So I think this particular story about Guadalupe serves to bridge a little bit of that. So yes, it is a devotion to Guadalupe, but it's not, it's an atypical devotion to Guadalupe. And it also bridges Latin America and the US, right? In a weird way, because Puerto Rico is very much a colony of the United States. There's a complicated political relationship there. But the ties between Puerto Rico and the US make this story an interesting bridge, right? I think that Latin American resources, Latin American literature and theology is utterly unknown in the United States, which is a crime. There are no, when we were in Peru, we were visiting with Gustavo Gutierrez, and he has an institute, right, Bartolomé de las Casas in Lima. We were at the library, and there are so many theological journals in Spanish from Latin America, none of which are in my library, right? My university library. None of which are in Florida's university library, which is much bigger even than it has. And I think that it says a lot about the way the American Academy views, or the US Academy views the rest of the Americas. And it's a shame, because it's a real, you know, it's a handicap that we put ourselves unnecessarily. So that's one of my goals, is to sort of bring in more dialogue with Latin American theologians, because there's no reason we should be so cut off.
We have time for one more question. In the United States, you kind of have a growing Catholic apartheid. It's going to be a minority, Northern European authority structure in the church, or the populace that's, you know, majority of the next. How do you see that? How do you see the church responding or competing with the growing Pentecostal, Disciples of Christ, all the Protestant denominations that have a little more flexibility in liturgical styles, worship styles, storytelling? That kind of growing, more flat kind of structure that is very attractive and is very competing for the church, and I don't think our Northern European bishops are ready for that.
Yeah, I think you're so right.
So how do we respond to that? How do you see us responding to that?
The one bishop who kind of really, well, first of all, he slept through my whole paper. That's one bishop. That was funny. I've never had a student snore in front of me, but I have. And then he woke up and said, well, you know, what are we going to do about all the Latinos who are leaving to the Pentecostal churches? And I was like, well, why do you think they're going? You know, and probably they're going because there's this sort of recognition of indigenous worship styles, right? There's a, like you said, a flexibility and a flatness in the leadership where anyone can preach. Now, there are obviously drawbacks to this, but maybe not, right? There's the sort of willingness to take risks with leadership that the church does not have and has not had, importantly, has not had for centuries, is now really presenting itself as a stumbling block, right? Certainly, I don't know how it is here in Texas, because this is maybe my second time in the state, but in the Northeast, it's a major problem. Right, and it's a racist problem, I don't mind saying, right? Where, you know, certain bishops don't see any value in popular religion, don't except in keeping numbers of people in the churches. Right? And you can't really rely on that. Because as you noted, right, there are churches where people feel valued and seen and included and not relegated to the basement, right? Or their Guadalupe gets moved to another day or something like that, or has to happen somewhere else because there's no space in the church, right? This kind of consistent devaluing or taking for granted is, it's becoming a stumbling block. And in fact, in the more recent studies of disaffiliation, right, people leaving the church, Latino youth is leaving the church at about the same rate as non-Latino millennials. So we're going to have a crisis. If we don't already have a crisis, we're going to have a crisis in terms of convincing young people that they are seen and valued in the church. I think that's what the Synod on Youth is supposed to do. Although a lot of the run-up to the Synod on Youth is, oh, kids these days with their cell phones, they don't know how to have any personal connections. And I gotta tell you, as someone who works with kids these days, that's not gonna do it, right? They don't want to be told that they are incapable of human connection because they are good at technology. Instead, what we should do is say, teach me how your human connections are different from mine and how I can incorporate that into the church, right? Why not let them lead and teach us instead of us feeling the need to always be? Thank you very much.
Provided insight into how we might at least begin to address them. Thank you so much.